Hi, my name is Ann Miles, and I'm here to talk to you about gamification in e-commerce, or as I like to refer to it, digital sales alchemy. This is a talk that I gave at the IRCE Digital Design Conference in LA in March 2015. I'm recording this in December of 2015, and I've made some refinements and additions to the presentation since I first gave it. So even if you heard it before, you might want to listen again. Why do I refer to gamification as alchemy? Alchemy, at its heart, is about the transformation of something common into something special. I believe that gamification, when done correctly, accomplishes this. Gamification is a buzzword these days. Most commonly, it's defined as an integration of game mechanics and concepts into non-game environments. In the online world, you'll see it with systems that have badges or points or leaderboards. In fact, the most gamified website online is eBay, but many people don't understand that. However, I first became interested in this topic when I commented on a website called ThinkGeek.com back in 2002. ThinkGeek has a contact form, like many websites do. The difference is, after you submit a comment to them, you can refresh the page and they will show you a random submission from another user. If you refresh enough, you might eventually see your own comment. I'm not alone in spending hours refreshing the page to see what interactive stories, jokes, and other mayhem the other users of that website had posted. This simple concept changed how I viewed their company. With that one system in place, I became part of a community, and they made me into a diehard fan. Points, badges, and leaderboards are known among gamification gurus as PBL. These systems are sold by a number of companies. A lot of people think only of these systems when they think of gamification. I hope to show you that there's much more to it than that. Game mechanics can be applied on a micro level to solve one particular problem with an interface or a process. Or it can be applied on a macro level into a system that works like a magnet to draw buyers. The secret to good implementation starts with considering your users and their motivations and goals. PBL, all by itself, can lead to burnout. It can have a negative effect on a business if not implemented thoughtfully. The problem is that when you implement PBL into a system that isn't suited for it, you're trying to apply a cookie-cutter solution to a complex problem, and it's not going to work. We'll talk more about why it won't work later, but right now, I want to show you an example of a PBL system done correctly. Step 2 is a toy company that worked with a company called Power Reviews to implement a gamified community. This community is called the Buzzboard. You can join just by making a post, and you become a newbie. As you share your experiences with the products, you can level up and progress to become a honeybee or a superbee. You can earn credits towards future purchases by writing reviews. The content is voted up or down by the other members of the community. This system has been a powerful tool for the company. It works because passionate parents are given a push to help other parents while getting the chance to be rewarded and recognized for the value that they provide to others. It's a great example of points, badges, and leaderboards done well. So what else can you implement besides points, badges, and leaderboards? If you go to the gamification wiki, you'll see a lot of these things that are listed here listed as game mechanics. Some of them are game mechanics, and some of them are game dynamics, but all of them can be repurposed or used as a catalyst for creative content or useful tools. I'm not going to talk about all of them here, but I will explain a few. Cascading information theory is the idea that people can get information overload. It's useful to present information in small pieces as someone goes through a process so that they don't get overwhelmed and quit. Epic meaning is the idea that you can join in and help a cause higher than yourself. Priming is a technique where you put an idea in someone's mind and let it simmer. You don't convince them, you just put the idea there, and it does have an effect. Urgent optimism is a game state where a user believes that they can win or get a reward, and then it's actually achievable. We're going to look at some examples of more of these dynamics, techniques, and mechanics later, but for now, it's good to realize that there's more to gamification than just PBL. Why does gamification work? It works because you are increasing the engagement level of the individual. You can do this simply, with just text and images, or you can do it subtly with processes and structures. You can go to the next level and use video or other dramatizations. The most immersive and engaging systems use simulations and interactive experiences. All of these can be gamified, helping you as a business owner to solve problems or communicate concepts. There are three main categories I'm going to focus on. These are persuasion, usability, and engagement. By applying gamification tools to different points in the sales process in these different modes, you can affect users' hearts, their bodies, and their minds. You can help them to feel smart, or helpful, or in control with the systems you build. Using these mechanics and tools, you affect how they feel about themselves. This, in turn, creates a positive reaction to your company and brand. In online scenarios, persuasion often involves persuading people to linger over a website or another piece of content. Persuasion also might be a focus when you're working on converting a lead to a prospect or a prospect to a buyer. Usability is often more about removing obstacles that might get in the way of the user taking the next step. Engagement involves not just getting a message across or having a user interact with your system, but also getting feedback. The ideal outcome, wherever you put your focus, is for users to move another step towards joining your brand's team. In studying cult branding, I've discovered that a lot of successful brands with passionate evangelists have consistently used gamification dynamics and techniques to do so. Companies like Apple, Volkswagen, and many others have been successful in capturing dedicated, outspoken followers. You can too. Okay, so if you're going to start selling online, you already know the four stages of the sales cycle. A person who is browsing is a prospect. When they decide you might have a solution for their problem, they're going to ask questions, and then they become a lead. When you convince them that you can meet their needs, they become a customer. They give you time or money, or both. As they use your product or service, then you meet their needs, and they begin to share their experiences with others. In e-commerce, this usually happens via your website, but it can actually begin on social media or review websites. Oddly enough, in a game adoption cycle, you have the same process. When a user might start playing a game, they are interested for some reason and they discover it. When they go through a tutorial to learn how to use the game or how the controls work or what the story or world is like, that's called onboarding. As they continue to play the game and build their character or level up, that process is called scaffolding. And then the player arrives at a win state. They experience endgame and hopefully eagerly await the next game in the franchise. In the four stages of the gamification cycle, the stages in the sales cycle and the stages in the game adoption cycle meet. This is where the magic happens. You have initiation, realization, transformation, and integration. In this gamification cycle, you're fusing mechanics and tools that game developers use to keep a gamer interested with different points of your sales cycle. you have a system that's driven by these tools. That system might exist independently on social media, or it might start on social media and move to your website. You might use these tools and techniques on only one stage of the sales cycle, or you might make a larger system that uses them in every stage. But hopefully, your goal is to bring the user onto your brand's team, to build a relationship with them. They become part of your nation, part of your fandom, part of the club. In that sense, a prospect gets initiated into your system. At the initiation stage, the user might say, "Hey, look at this, it's really great." And then that will be followed by realization. "Hey, I want to learn more about this." If you successfully answer their questions or solve their problems, then the user turns into a buyer. They spend time and money with you. Ideally, they're so excited by your system and brand that they share your greatness with others and become integrated with you. They're your supporters, your cheerleaders, your family. Our goal is for you to have as many of those as you can. In this model, gamification isn't transaction-focused, it's relationship-focused. And your objective overall is to establish and maintain those relationships. There are two types of buyers, relational buyers and transactional buyers. A relational buyer will go to a place to purchase because they have a relationship with the brand. A transactional buyer will go to a place only because of price. Your repeat buyers, the ones who will be your bread and butter, whether you are selling a product or a service, are your relational buyers. Gamification can be a catalyst to reach more of those in less time. These tools can also solve specific problems and help you reach measurable goals. Okay, so as a recap, we've learned that gamification isn't just PBL, points, badges, and leaderboards. Gamification techniques, when applied to marketing and e-commerce, can be applied to the different parts of the sales cycle and fused to help your brand accomplish their goals. These methods may or may not involve the use of overt games. Many times the methods are subtle. When done by masters, the methods are very, very, very subtle, but they're equally effective. Do you have to be a game designer to implement gamification? No. I believe that any skilled creative can implement gamification, but they do have to learn to think in a new way. They have to be able to see how it's done and look at a new perspective at the problems they're trying to solve. They have to look at users' motivations and then tie those to the goals that you want to achieve. I call that thinking diagonally. Congratulations! You've made it through the intro to gamification and passed your initiation as a digital sales alchemist. Next, we're going to look at examples of specific methods being applied to different stages of the sales cycle. So how do we do this? We're going to look now at a few low-tech examples that apply to only one part of the sales cycle. Remember that I said you can use persuasion techniques, usability techniques, or engagement techniques? Sometimes you need attention, sometimes you need focus, and sometimes you need feedback. Determining what you need to solve your problem is the first step. So we're going to look at some real companies and try to understand what their problems were and how they approached them, and then examine their results. When you're in the prospecting or initiation stage, you want to garner attention in a fresh way and move the user from being a prospect to being a lead. You have different actions you want them to perform, and often this involves getting an email address. When someone gives you their email address, they're giving you permission to contact them and moving to that next stage in the relationship. They're becoming a lead. Sometimes it's hard to persuade someone to do that. Skilled Up is a software training company. They had a campaign where they were teaching Excel and a landing page to sell that training program. They invited users to sign up to get more information about their training, but they were only getting about 20 new email subscribers each month. In an effort to convert more prospects into leads, they implemented a quiz that would test the skills of the people who were interested. At the end of the quiz, the person could opt in to get more information via email from Skilled Up. This lead magnet generated a 2,400% increase in subscribers. Why? It communicated in an authentic and fun way that the user needed the company's product, and it also appealed to their curiosity. It also demonstrated how the company practices their service. The next example is both an example of using persuasion tools in the prospecting sales stage and in the lead sales stage as an engagement tool. When you see it, you'll see why. The tool developed functioned as both a lead magnet because of its beauty, driving downloads of the trial software, and also as a tool to keep the attention and focus of the target audience. Autodesk is a company that makes imaging software, and they're best known as the makers of AutoCAD. But they also make software used by game developers or the special effects industry. For their 3D Max software package, they implemented a gamification system that was both a lead magnet, capturing the eyes of their prospects and drawing them in, and an effective tool to convert leads into buyers. On the left, we see the normal landing page for the product, and on the right, the game program they ran in 2013 for their 3D Max software. This program invited users to sign up for their free trial. Tutorials were presented as missions. The users followed a quest, exploring the content. They engaged with other trial users in an online community. This was a rousing success. By appealing to the target audience and their love of exploring and creativity, they were able to increase engagement, capturing attention initially, and then turning leads into buyers. You can do the same thing that Autodesk did on a smaller scale using inviting graphics and a fun metaphor, illustrating your service. Even a simple graphic and a series of pages in HTML can accomplish the same objectives. Sometimes a sale will be made because people like you more. You seem nicer, more friendly. Think I'm wrong? I'll give you an example. You need dish detergent. I'm going to say three words, and I want you to close your eyes and think about the emotional reaction you have to these names. Ready? Kmart. Walmart. Target. If all three of these stores are side by side, which one will you go to? Did you have an emotional response to those brands? Why? The next example is something I noticed on HubSpot years ago, and we're starting to see it everywhere, but it's worth mentioning. It's a small thing that leads to big changes in how people react to you emotionally. HubSpot creates online marketing software. They have a tool that you can use to evaluate your website for SEO called the Website Grader. There are many tools out there to evaluate your website, but what made HubSpot stand out was the loading messages. Loading messages are often used by game companies to tell small factoids of information about the game. HubSpot uses them to prime you for sales. Remember I talked about priming? It's when you plant an idea in someone's mind, and it's proven to affect decision making. Those messages can be fun and surprising. And in HubSpot's case, you actually couldn't wait for the screen to load to see what they were going to say next. Look at the one in the example. You're free to get found by more leads. That's an example of gentle priming to use HubSpot's product. These can easily be implemented on any website instead of a loader graphic. They're effective because they take advantage of a scenario where a user might be bored and they use it to engage them. That's genius. Simple graphics can be very powerful, They can also be a great catalyst for evangelism, a hot point to talk about your product. They can be a game in themselves, as you'll see in this next example. M&M's made a simple Facebook post in 2013 with this image and the words, "Oh no, I've lost the pretzel guy. Can you help me spot him?" That one post garnered over 25,000 likes, 6,000 shares, and 10,000 comments. To put this into perspective, social media intelligence companies have valued a like at between $10 and $174, depending on the product. Shares were very integral to the success of my next example, which built their business on a freemium model. Dropbox gamified sharing and rewarded users with free service for sharing their service with others. Users of this file sharing service were offered 7 quests to follow to become a guru. Their reward was extra space. They started with a normal online advertising budget, but it wasn't effective, so they dropped it and put everything into word of mouth and this referral program, and it paid off. It paid off handsomely. And see their quest? That's a simple checklist. Sometimes you want to use usability techniques found in games or game systems to make an impact or to get leads. I define usability as anything that affects the body or the way that the person interacts with your system physically. Usually that means your eyes and your hands. Most of the time it deals with navigation. How do they get to the click? How is that made easier? Sometimes a technique can be applied to how you are found, as in the next example. That example is pretty brilliant, taking advantage of proximity and boredom to turn a downtime into an opportunity. You go out to eat with your kids, and you order your food. You're waiting for the food to arrive, and what do? You look at the objects on the table. Many times, that includes a bottle of Heinz ketchup. So on the back of that bottle is a QR code, and if you scan it, you can play a fun trivia game while you're waiting. What could be better than that? One of the questions is even used again as priming. Would being able to play this game prompt you to ask for Heinz ketchup at other restaurants? Even if you say no, the idea has been put in your mind. Cascading information theory is the idea that you should present only the most relevant information to a user so you don't overwhelm them and cause them to click away. In this next example, we did this with our client, an accounting firm, with an unusual navigation model. Jones Nail Mattingly had a site that listed dozens of services and markets in their main menu when we met them. They had a drop-down, and it was big. Users didn't know where to click first, and they had to hunt for relevant information. By dividing their menus out into tunnels for individuals and for businesses, we increased the time that users spent on their site, as well as earning them many more conversions. In the next example, a domain name makes it easy for users to participate in an epic meeting. Amazon Smile is a program that any user can enroll in. By going to smile.amazon.com and shopping there, you can make a difference for the charity of your choice. Amazon donates to the charity that you choose and gives to them in a ratio to the products you buy using Amazon Smile. You don't have to do anything but use the different domain name. So given the choice, which one would you do? Go to target.com or go to smile.amazon.com? Usability techniques often provide feedback at points of intention. One online retailer uses usability techniques to police its service and to encourage reviews. The most gamified website online is eBay. When I think of gamification in a gamified system, I think of eBay immediately. because top-down, it's gamified. The whole platform is a game. I just want to focus on one game mechanic here, though, the ratings for sellers. The problem that eBay had was if they had users who were unethical, their platform wouldn't be used. They implemented a rating system with yes scores in a unique way. These simple stars and seller scores are the key to the trust that users put in the platform. They're placed prominently where the buyer or shopper can see them, next to the product. By offering this prominent rating system to its users, eBay creates an ecosystem of integrity and accountability. Buyers are honor-bound by the system to share good, honest feedback. That happens after the sale, and it's at the evangelization point of the sales cycle. This is a critical part of the success of the website. Okay, so we've looked at different applications and examples of low-tech solutions to problems different companies had. Most of the time, you won't recognize these creative ideas as games. You're seeing elements, concept, techniques, or UI patterns found in games to solve problems or approach different aspects of the sales cycle. You might notice I didn't really talk a whole lot about engagement techniques in these examples. Most of them, however, I hope you will agree, are engaging on their own. Games use surprise and fun to engage. By implementing these techniques, you're introducing the element of surprise for your user, and their engagement level increases immediately. But we're going to talk more about engagement and fun. So, congratulations, you're now an apprentice in digital sales alchemy, and you have earned the right to get my gamification planning template. If you got this far, go ahead and tweet to me. Even though you're not at my presentation, I'll send it to you. Okay. So at this next level, we're going to examine some thoughtful tools to help you not unlock the mayor badge of meaninglessness. We've looked at gamification examples, and I want to talk a little bit about why those programs work and the best way to create and implement one for yourself. This graphic illustrates the frustration that a user can have with PBL programs that are implemented poorly. But it's my contention that this frustration can happen with any gamified program that isn't done with thought, caring, and authenticity. Remember in elementary school when the teacher had a star chart? It might have motivated you as a youngster, but as you grew older, you likely became impatient with it. The same thing can happen to users. People don't want to feel bribed. They don't want to feel manipulated. The ultimate test of whether a gamified system works is how it makes the users feel. If users are impatient with it, they will move on or become angry that you've tried to manipulate them. They might try to game the system. They might try to use it for their own gain and not care about you and leave. This usually does result in low long-term retention, and if you're looking for user-generated content, you're not going to get much, or if you get any at all, it won't be of very high quality. So I call that the pointsification chasm, and we want to avoid that. How do you avoid it? Well, the biggest and most important thing you can do is to know what specific outcomes you want and understand your users and their needs and goals. Listen to the feedback you receive. We talked about Autodesk a little while ago, and they had huge success with their 3D Max trial program. But the next year, they implemented a very similar program for their AutoCAD users. You know what? It fell flat. It was the same type of program and they did all of the same things. Why did it fail? The first program was aimed at graphics and development experts, people who were interested in beautiful things. They had different things that they found fun. The second program was aimed at engineers. Their personality type was completely different. A graphic artist is going to be intrigued by exploration and opportunities to create, but an engineer is very interested in being efficient and in solving problems quickly. Understanding your user and their motivation is the key to successful campaigns. Campaigns must be fun. There are actually 7 types of fun. Isn't that great? 7 types of fun. Sensation or sense, pleasure, fantasy, and make-believe, narrative, or an unfolding story, challenge, like an obstacle course, or a puzzle, fellowship, that's a social framework, a community that you can join, discovery, uncharted territory that you can get into, expression, which can be a soapbox, or submission, which is a mindless pastime, like bubble wrap. In the Autodesk example, discovery, sensation, and fantasy are important to many creatives. So the first campaign worked. Engineers might lean more towards challenges. When you're designing a system, you want to think about how the users will feel when interacting with your website, email, or app. The opportunities you give them should be fun for them, and they should allow opportunities for autonomy, mastery, and purpose, even if on the micro level. First off, people should always have a choice to opt out easily. Any gamified system you create shouldn't be a hassle. Then, in your systems themselves, you need to offer choices and make it easy for them to understand. Giving someone a choice not to take a certain path on your site or in your app might be as important as offering the right words on a buy button. Offering a quick fun video related to a common problem they face. Giving people opportunities to connect to others or to feel smart. Or best of all, inviting them into a higher purpose. Those are all ways that you can avoid that pointsification chasm. These are called intrinsic motivators. Intrinsic motivators are internal drives, things that all of us want. Instead of being motivated by external forces like wages or stars on a chart, you're motivated by your desires. By tapping into intrinsic motivators liberally to fuel your system, you balance out the extrinsic motivators and avoid those terrible feelings of manipulation or impatience that can come from a gamified system. Okay. So now we're going to look at some websites and apps that integrate game design at a higher level than the subtle examples I've given previously. These more easily illustrate the different types of fun and the intrinsic motivators behind them. The Covet fashion app leverages paper dolls and allows for creativity. Users put together outfits, they can vote on them, they can vote on their looks and closet them, and best of all, they can buy any piece in the ensemble. This free play exploration is truly fun, and it offers autonomy and discovery. Drop Till You Shop brings dueling to e-commerce with a unique take on bidding. People have said it's either the best or the worst thing to happen to e-commerce, and the jury's still out, but it seems to be pretty successful. A price ticker below each item runs down, and users hit it when they see a number they like. Then they're transferred to a checkout page, and the first person to check out wins the item. Users feel the win or the burning desire to defeat others. The result has been described as addictive. Perhaps no gamified system is as immersive as America's Army. This combines purpose with fantasy. The recruiting tool packs fantasy into a massively entertaining package to give prospects a simulated look into life as a soldier. This system has attracted millions of recruits and remains a top tool for armed forces. The secret to lasting bonds and deep impact on a person's relationship with your brand is the combination of shared goals, catalysts in the form of intrinsic motivators, and good old-fashioned fun. Congratulations, you now have the tools to be a journeyman digital alchemist. For an idea generator that helps you get great ideas for your own campaigns, you can subscribe to my newsletter. I'm not going to spam you, and if you feel like you're being spammed, you can opt out at any time. I'm going to send you a link to the tool, and I might occasionally send out use cases or examples to help you. We're coming to the end game of this presentation, and I want to look at ways to use games themselves in your marketing. Games can be your vehicle for engagement. That all-important metric, time on site, was boosted by the Home Shopping Network when they added a series of simple arcade games to their website. Users can earn credits to use towards items sold on the website, but the genius was that while they played those arcade games, the network was broadcasting in the window next to the game. See it there on the right? Users doubled the time spent on their site, and they got exposed to products they might never otherwise have noticed. The results speak for themselves. Last, I want to talk about a mobile game played on iOS and Android. Ingress is an augmented reality game, and it has its roots in Google, who originally helped start the game. It's run by a company called Niantic Labs. Ingress is a location-based, massive multiplayer game played on mobile phones all over the world. It's had over 10 million downloads. Companies like Hintwater, AXA Insurance, Zipcar, and Anchor have all done partnerships with Ingress to increase brand awareness and to drive sales. They've sponsored in-game items or promotions, and the extremely devoted user base has responded by purchasing. Whether you integrate your brand into a game or you use games to enhance your web presence, you can build a community, garner name recognition, and win significant market share by using a vehicle that fits your audience. You can apply techniques to a process to make it easier or more engaging. You can use gamification tools to solve problems and hopefully grow your company's sales. I hope this presentation has inspired you to try. Again, I'm Ann Miles. I'm the founder and toad-in-chief at Red Toad Media. You can find me on the web at redtoadmedia.com. Thanks for listening.